talking and touching on some seriously intense topics. Basically, we'll be talking about addiction this week. We'll then be going on to mental health and suicide the next week, and then the fourth week of February, we may touch on sexuality as well. Before I begin today, I just want you to hear my heart. I want you to know that I believe that there are people all over the world who are in desperate need of Jesus Christ, because we all are experiencing some pain and some hurt from this world. And that because we are experiencing, because we're experiencing this pain, you know, God wants to help us through. Everybody in the world has something that brings pain to them. Whether it's physical pain, whether it's mental pain, whether it's intense relationships that seem to go in a direction that we're not ready to go, or whether somebody takes advantage of us, everybody has a real struggle. You see, life is full of situations and choices and events and regrets and traumas and abuse and sexuality issues and mental health issues and hunger and anger and grief and so much more that we need an answer. And we believe that Jesus Christ is the answer here at Adventure Church. That the answer to these issues is not found in the world. That the world offers us a lot of things that aren't helpful to us. That the world offers us things that in the end lead us even further down a path of destruction. And unfortunately, most people don't realize that they're trapped until it's too late. And then by then, many of them don't even care. The Bible offers us very clear instructions about many areas in our lives. And it provides us with the only means of salvation that is offered to this world, that promises us salvation now and experiencing God now and in eternity. And so we're going to take a look at a passage today in the book of Proverbs that deals directly with the dangers of addiction. And if you have your Bibles with you today, I encourage you and hope that you do have your Bibles with you today. I encourage you to open them to Proverbs chapter 23, and we'll be looking at verses 29 through 35. And I just want to give you a little bit of background as you turn there, and as you see the scriptures are on the screen if you need them as well. Proverbs is a book of wisdom literature. It covers three specific areas. The first area is a book, a set of proverbs that deals specifically with like gaining wisdom. Knowing what wisdom is and the virtues of wisdom and living out a godly life and what it means to be godly and to avoid the world and the destruction that comes with the world. The second section of the book is a book of sayings that deals with a bunch of life issues. It allows you to be able to look at addiction, or it allows you to be able to look at the plight of people that are in abusive relationships and things like this. And then the third section is wisdom advice to leaders. And so Proverbs 23, 29 through 35 falls right in the second section, which, as I said, is a bunch of sayings. Now, the sayings aren't necessarily related to one another. They're just sayings as you go through. This allows the proverb writer to be able to cover a plethora of life issues. And so it's not, we're talking about addiction today, like the next saying is going to be about addiction. That's not true. He's going through a bunch of life issues and allows him to cover a large area and provide wisdom to those who will listen. And so the author follows this format, and you will see that there's sayings and sayings and sayings through chapters and chapters and chapters of Proverbs. And so in Proverbs 23, 29 through 35, the author offers us a warning about addiction. And we're going to look at that today. So Proverbs 23, 29, 35. Here we go. Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has strife? Who has complaining? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who tarry long over wine. Those who try mixed drinks. Do not look at the wine when it's red, when it sparkles in the cup and goes down smoothly. In the end, it bites like a serpent and stings like an adder. Your eyes will see strange things, and your hearts will utter perverse things. You will be one like one who lays down in the midst of the sea, like one on the top of a mast. They struck me, you will say, but I was not hurt. They beat me, but I did not feel. When shall I awake? I must have another drink. There's a lot of information contained in these verses, and it's very easy for us to read Proverbs and to go, yeah, I got that. We don't want you to leave here today and just go, yeah, I read it, I got it. We want to take a few moments over the next 30 minutes or so to walk you through these chapters, these verses, in smaller sections. And so as we break that down, the first section of verses that we're going to look at again is 29 and 30. It says, who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has strife? Who has complaining? Who has words without wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who tarry long over wine. Those who go to try mixed drinks. The author initially gives us six different areas where addiction causes issues. First one is woe, that there is a great distress. That the distress doesn't necessarily begin before the addiction, but it's intensified by the consumption of alcohol or drugs in the modern day world. See, there's a great distress that addiction brings. There is sorrow, deep pain and regret. There's complaining, strife, there are disagreements, anger, bitterness, resentment, conflicts with others. And then it says, wounds without cause, that many of these wounds are being caused not by life situations, but by the fact that there is an addiction problem, that there is a problem with consuming too much wine. And that in order to rectify that, we need to be warned about the situations that can come along. And we are wise to listen to what the Proverbs writer has to say. Then he goes on and says, redness of eyes. There's a tiredness, a cloudiness. These more wounds without cause. That there is a breakdown in our bodies and in our souls that deflates us as that pain intensifies. And as alcohol wraps its arms around us and squeezes us to death. You know, while the pain in this world is intense, there is pain in this world. Whether we can see it or not, there are people that deal with pain in the world that is not seen by others. It's easy to look at somebody and say, oh yeah, they have a broken leg or a broken hip or they had a heart attack or whatever. It's easy for us to look at that and to have compassion for them. But then there are people in the world who struggle inside, who struggle with mental health issues, who have turned to things like alcohol and drugs to go and to try to correct the issues that this world gives us. And we look at them and we say, ew. What's wrong with that person? They don't have a broken leg. They're just being irresponsible. It's so easy for us to do that. And God says, you know, there is intense pain in this world, and we're called to have compassion on people. Because Jesus had compassion on people with problems. So, what the author is saying here is that the pains in this world are not going to be solved by addiction, by drinking wine, by getting drunk, by getting high. He confronts us with an unwelcoming truth that the very feelings that we're trying to suppress, the woe, the sorrow, the complaining, the strife, the redness of eyes, are actually intensified by the misuse of alcohol or drugs. No one ultimately wants to experience these six things. The world tries to offer us escapes, and those escapes are very short-lived. They are temporary escapes. But once the mind believes that that's the escape that is going to give us the most hope, it latches on, and the cycle of addiction continues. So one drink that, or use of illicit drugs that relieves pain then becomes a cycle of, my pain is increasing because I'm using. And now I need more of the same thing to relieve that pain that I'm feeling. Those wounds without cause continue to be poured out on us because of our addictions. You see, that one grows tired of the pain and sorrow and anguish. And then the next thing you know, we're taking more hits and drinking more alcohol. Because at one time provided us some relief. But in order to gain that same relief each time, we have to take more. It lures us in. You see, there's an intensity in our lives, a desire in our lives to avoid pain and to find the easiest and quickest route to get out. And the next set of verses tells us that each and every one of us can be tempted by alcohol, by wine, by addiction. Verses 31 and 32 read this way. Do not look at wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it goes down smoothly. In the end, it bites like a serpent and stings like an adder. Our second point is addiction is tempting. Addiction is tempting. This is, don't even look at it. Don't even look at it when it's red and when it sparkles in the cup, when it looks inviting, when it offers you something that it really can't give you. So the easiest way to avoid being tempted is to avoid temptation. He uses two things, the way that wine tempts us. It's pleasing to the eye. It looks desirable. It looks like it's going to do something that can help us. It tastes good is the second. It has no bite. Does that sound familiar? Genesis 3, anybody? Look at this fruit. It's desirable to the eyes and desirable to eat. It promised us something that God said, you don't need. God is saying, don't reach out and eat that fruit. And Adam and Eve take the fruit and they eat of it. And the next thing they know, they've lost their relationship with God, and suddenly there's strife between both of them. People say, no, don't do this. It's for your protection. It's for your good. And the writer of Proverbs here is saying the same thing. Listen, this is for your protection. Listen to me. These are the dangers of drinking too much. These are the dangers of taking a hit. But people say, well, look, if it looks good and it tastes good and it offers me some relief, how can it be so bad? But see, the promises that are contained in that cup or needle or pill or pipe or powder or whatever it is that allures us, it draws us in and then it slams the door behind us and we can't escape. What does he say here in verse 32? In the end, it bites like a serpent and stings like an adder. You can be standing right next to an adder and not even know it's there. You can be admiring the beauty of the world. And camouflaged next to you can be a serpent that can immediately take your life. One false step promises to unravel our lives. So the writers of Proverbs are saying, listen, this is poison. This can poison your life. Don't tarry long over it. If it makes you feel too good, take a hike. Avoid it. Stay away. One of my friends described the spiral of addiction this way. First of all, it starts out like this. It's my cute little puppy. It's fun. It's exciting. It's like everybody has a puppy. I want a puppy. Right? Then it becomes this loyal companion, the one that's there when the pain is too intense, the one that's there when all his friends ditch him, the ones that there when he loses his job or when he can't get a hold of somebody to help him. That's his buddy. That's his companion. Yeah, buddy. My alcohol is right here. My drug is right here. And then one day, that cute little puppy that would make us feel good suddenly becomes Cujo. And Cujo attacks us and destroys our lives. That what we once thought was our friend is now destroying our lives. See, what he thought was fun at age 12 suddenly turned into waking up in a bar parking lot at 7 a.m. And not waking up, like waking up from having passed out the night before. Waking up at 7 a.m. to help the bartender open the bar and then start his day of drinking again. And meanwhile, as his health deteriorated and things started to fall apart, his friends came to him, his family came to him and said, listen, this alcohol has destroyed your life. And he said, don't you blame my alcohol. It's you people. It's not my alcohol. Don't you blame that puppy over there. It's you people. And he began to drink to find out who to blame for the fact that his life was falling apart because good old alcohol was there to help him. And the structure of his life continued even after he literally owned nothing, rode a borrowed bike to the bar every day, passed out, and got up. He began to experience grand mal seizures from alcohol withdrawal because his alcohol level was 0.44 when they tested him. So much alcohol that as he's coming off of it, he's having seizures because of alcohol withdrawal. His body can't live without it. And instead of blaming the alcohol, you know what he does? He goes and he drinks more furiously. He starts using other drugs, abusing prescription drugs. He downs an entire bottle of muscle relaxers with alcohol, wakes up 2.5 days later with DNR written across his chest, extremely thirsty, with no thought of trying to live through his 40s. And so for 36 gut-wrenching years, this man abused alcohol and it destroyed his life. And finally, one day, as cops are sitting around him, and he sits up and he thinks, maybe they're right, maybe it is the alcohol. He checks himself into rehab, goes to hundreds of AA meetings, and today he's 5 years clean. Incredible stories. But a poison that destroyed his life. And that's not a story that everybody can tell. You see, our next point is that addiction destroys. It poisons us. Toward the end of our lives, we become ensnared in the trap of addiction. Toward the end of the addiction process. And we slowly begin to unravel. First of all, the mind. Says here, your eyes will see strange things, and your heart will utter perverse things. You will be like one who lies down in the midst of the sea, like one who lies on top of the mast. See, the mind begins to struggle to comprehend all the pain that it's feeling. Remember, pain can trigger addiction. But pain gets intensified by that addiction. And so your mind can't comprehend, well, why is this world falling apart when I have something over here that's promising me relief? So it's got to be something out there. And as neurons begin to die and addicts' abilities begin to fade, the bitterness and strife and anger and resentment mount and mount and mount. And the mind can't comprehend it. So what does it do? It tries to dull the pain. It can't realize that what it craves the most, the next hit or drink or snort or so on, is the exact problem that's destroying their life. And eventually, even rehab becomes a threat to them. Rehab becomes a threat. And it turns only a relapse rate of 40 to 60% of people who actually make it out of rehab. That's not counting the people that didn't make it the 90 days or 6 months or whatever it is. 40 to 60% of them relapse. You see, our minds were not created to withstand the abuse of drugs and alcohol. And he goes on to say, your hearts will say perverse things. See, the heart slowly begins to speak things it doesn't really believe. Bitterness, anger, wretchedness, wickedness, resentment begin spewing out of the mouth as people try to help and feelings of misery take over. And what eventually happens is the addict finds himself with a bottle or a pill or a needle or a pipe all alone. They're drowned. They're suffering. Like one laying in the middle of the sea. Like one laying on top of a mast. Life is passing them by. And they're looking, what went wrong? addiction poisons our relationship with one another, and addiction poisons our relationship with God. The pain and hurt and anguish that's felt before addiction begins can only be healed by a relationship with Jesus Christ. By his love for us, by his sacrifice for us, by his promise that he will never leave or forsake us, that he will walk through us, come to him, all who are weary and heavy laden. Lay your burdens down. You see, the world has a lot to offer. Things that we think are going to help us, but only Jesus Christ and his love for mankind can save us from ourselves and from hell. See, we weren't created to feel pain and misery initially. God didn't desire for us to experience these things. God didn't want for us to experience the pain and the sorrows that come with life, whether it's loss of a job or a divorce or the loss of a home or going bankrupt or, you know, experiencing addiction. God didn't want for that to happen, but we didn't listen to the warnings he gave us in the garden. Do not eat that fruit. And it looks like God's trying to control us. That sounds like God's trying to control us, that he's holding something back. There's a lesson to be learned there, that God loves us so much that he sets boundaries so that we're not destroyed. And so in Proverbs, we look at this, and we can do one of two things with this set of verses. We can say, yeah, I got it. We can say, I'm not really going to pay attention. So one of three things, okay? I'm not going to pay attention to it. I'm going to do what I want. Or number three, I'm going to follow this because I believe that God has a better plan for me. That God has a plan that is better for my life. That God is the only thing that can help me and heal me ultimately. He's warning us, just like in the garden. Be careful. Be careful, because it will draw you in and destroy you. The Bible tells us that we don't just have an advocate in heaven named Jesus, but that we have an advocate in heaven named Jesus who can relate to our pain, who can relate to what it means to be human, who experienced things that we will never experience because of who he is. He's called the Man of Sorrows for a reason. He experienced the world in a way that we will never experience the world, and he experienced the wrath of God on the cross like we will never experience it because of what he did for us. But that requires us to come to him for his mercy and his grace and his salvation and his love. You see, healing from our pain can only come from kneeling at the cross of Jesus Christ and saying, I need you, because I can't do this myself. I need somebody who's constantly merciful and graceful and loving towards me. The only way that we can find that person and avoid the judgment of God is to come to him through Jesus Christ. Jesus knows our heartaches and our temptations and our pain, and he invites us to lay them down on him. The last point I want to make today, and the story that's coming up is a little graphic, but it brings home the fact that addiction ultimately alters our reality. Addiction alters our reality. Listen to what the proverb says here. They struck me, verse 35, you will say, but I was not hurt. They beat me, but I did not feel. When shall I awake? I must have another drink. The last set of verses shows us that eventually the mind cares nothing else about nothing else except getting that next hit, getting the next high, getting the next drink. I was struck and I felt nothing. My life has become a pursuit of nothing but alcohol or heroin or cocaine or addiction. Our lives begin to be destroyed by that. And regardless of what we think, drugs and alcohol will eventually take over, becoming our God that we worship and destroying our lives. And so I'm going to leave you with this story. pastors always have that conclusion. I'll leave you with this story. Addiction alters reality. I have a friend who's a doctor. And he received a text message from another doctor that was in the emergency room. And this girl came in, and she was in a group of people that were all getting high and smoking dope and popping pills and shooting up. And she took a hit of some really, really clean meth. The next thing they know, in this group of people, this girl is reaching into her eye sockets and pulling her eyes out of her head. She slams them on the concrete, and then she begins to chew on them. Addiction alters our reality, for somehow, in that lady's mind, she saw that as the best thing to do. There are real dangers in addiction. There are real people who are really hurting. I guarantee you the next day when that lady woke up, she regretted that decision. Because what happened? There were wounds without cause. She didn't heed the warning of people who cared about her, who said, please listen to me. This is going to destroy you. And the next thing that she knows, she wakes up, she can't see anything. You see, the warnings and problems play out in our daily lives. Listen, there are people in Harker County who are experiencing the same kind of thing. Who are looking at this world and are going, my pain is so great, I need to find something. And that something is not drugs, it is Jesus Christ. And the church has a responsibility to go into their communities and say, we're here to help you. Not to sit back and watch the police arrest people, or not to see a mother holding their child who's just overdosed and who's dying in her arms. The church exists to go out and help people. And that's why Venture Church exists. Venture Church wants to show the grace and the love and the mercy of Jesus Christ to people all across Harker County and beyond. Because people are hurting like that. That is somebody's child. You see, we believe that God is the only answer to our anguish, to our loneliness, to our pain. That the only way that we can conquer all things is through the grace, love, mercy, and salvation of Jesus Christ. That he offers us this salvation with open hands. That his son hanging on a cross and dying for people who were spitting on him and ripping out his hair and beating him to death and then nailing him to a cross and he's hanging there naked and they're making fun of him. That very God says, I still love you. That very God is the same God that we can trust with our hurts, with our pains, with our sorrows, with our woes, with our complaints, with our redness of eyes. But it requires us bending the knee at the cross and saying, I'm a sinner. I'm in need of salvation. I need you to forgive me, to help me, to equip me to live out my ultimate purpose, which is to love God and love others, and then enjoy him forever. I want to make it clear that, you know, you come to Jesus, he's not automatically, necessarily, this has happened, I've seen this happen, where somebody's come to Jesus and they were immediately clean. They didn't have any other desire for their drug or alcohol or pipe. It doesn't necessarily mean that, but instead of facing it alone and watching people abandon you as you continue to fail, now you have an advocate who's going to say, come on, we got this, we can do it. Let's go. Jesus Christ is going to stand right there and fight with you. And it won't be easy. And it might look like you fail in the end. But ultimately, Jesus gives us the healing that we desire. A healing from our sin. A healing for our souls. And a healing for eternity. So the question is, are you ready to come to the cross today? Are you ready to set aside the things the world says will work? Are you ready to set aside the spoon or the joint or the needle or the pot or whatever it might be, whatever your drug of choice, and look to God, a God who says, come to me, child, and I will help you. I will give you rest. it's okay and I love you.